I'm Nydia.
I'm Smoltz.
Thank you.
Can you hear me? My name is Cindy Mills. I'm the District 4 County Commissioner. And I could really cry because so many of you come out. We didn't know when we were planning this if we would have 10 people other than us that were planning it that would show up. And I think this is really representative of a community that cares. And I'm so proud to be a part of it. We have had a wonderful committee that's been meeting over the past few weeks. And if I'm starting any names, I will leave some of them out. If you've been part of our committee, if you will, wave your hand. These people have been coming and helping and working, trying to put this together. We have never tried, or I've just been on the county commission since January, so I'm still figuring out what I'm doing. But we had never had a collaborative effort where the school system and judicial and Forsyth County and our sheriff's office is a department. And we've all came together to try to make a difference and to recognize. You know, it seems like in the community, we love the Chamber of Commerce speeches, all of us do, because we've got so much to be proud of and so much to brag about. And we have a great community. We have great churches and great organizations and great youth sports and great SAT scores. And I mean, we're thriving and growing, and we've got, but sometimes we get lost in all of that, that there's issues we need to be talking about. And there's, any time you've got a child, and that's near and dear to my heart, that you have a child that's suffering, a child that needs help, a parent. And that's where it came together for parents, because we feel like so many children, they get educated. It might not be the way, you know, the school system is wonderful and they offer all different kinds of things for the children to understand about drugs and the harmfulness of drugs, but all of a sudden, a real close friend of mine's son started going through this, and she was like, I don't know where to turn. I don't know where to go for help. And she had never heard of black tar heroin, never dreamed that her child could be injecting or going through things like this. It was just as one of the speakers will be saying, this can't be happening in my home. It just can't be. And I think that just this host of people shows how much you care, how much you care about your children, how much you care about your community, how you're supportive of this. And I just thank you so much that, and we hope that this is just the first step. When I was working on social services committee through the Board of Commissioners and also working with juvenile justice, we kept hearing a reoccurring thing that there's drugs in the community. There is children that are suffering. There's children that and parents that don't know what's going on. And so through that, we all started talking about we need to do something. We feel like their parents just kept coming up saying, why don't you offer something? Why don't you help? Why don't you do so? We wanted to be that. We wanted to be that kind of community that did offer that and that did come together. And we don't want it to stop with this event. We want this to be the springboard to starting having other events, to having other support groups that will come and parents that are going through this that'll have a place. We want to form a drug coalition in the county where you can go and not worry and be able to get drug testing and be able to have a resource that can point you in the right direction to get help for your child. And so that's all the things that we hope will come from this. This is not, I don't want you to think this is a one-time event. This is a commitment from the community, and we're going to hopefully be performing, coming together and putting together the drug coalition that will need a board, we'll need people to serve on it, we'll need people to volunteer, we'll need to fundraise, we'll need to do different things, and all in mind that we're doing this for the kids. We're doing this to help our community. We want our community to always be the best that it can be. And I wanted to thank our sponsors for this event that I've already mentioned, Forsyth County Schools and Forsyth County Government, Forsyth County Sheriff's Office, Forsyth County Judicial, Community Connection, Children's Healthcare, and North Forsyth Rotary provided the t-shirts, and then the Department of Behavioral Health all came together to help do the bags and different things. And we want to make sure that we get your email, that we can stay in touch with you. We're also Mr. Smoltz was so gracious to sign us some baseballs for door prizes. We're going to give away at the end. So that's the way we know we're going to get your name and your email, because you're going to want to try to get a baseball. I wanted to thank also the people, the leaders that are in the room, and I hope I don't leave some of you out. I know that we have State Representative Mike Dungeon, and we have State Representative Kevin Tanner, our county commissioners, Chairman Pete Davis and Todd Levent, our school board members, and some others might have come in. I saw Chairman Darla Light, Ann Crow, and Kristen Morrissey, if I've left anybody. Judge McClellan, Judge Leslie Abernathy Maddox, our Solicitor General Donna Gopal, and District Attorney Penny Penn. And thank y'all all for coming. I know that we've got several that work with Drug Corps, that work with the UI Corps, have all helped us on this, and we appreciate it so much. And now we will just, I'm not going to stop by introducing everybody that's up here. We're just going to go in the order of the speakers. And our first speaker, our keynote speaker, and I'm so thankful that he was gracious enough to come, is John Smoltz. John's family, he is married to Catherine. He has a son, John Andrew Jr., daughters Rachel, Carly, Kelly, Ashley, and Sarah Catherine. His hometown's Atlanta, Georgia. I don't have to tell you all what an incredible pitcher he was. We all were doing the tomahawk chop and cheering him on as we got that World Series. He has been the World Series in 1995, an eight-time Major League Baseball All-Star. He was MVP of the 1992 National League Championship Series. He's one of only 16 pitchers in Major League Baseball history to record 3,000 strikeouts during his career. He's a Cy Young Award winner, Robert Clemente Community Service Award, the Branch Rickey Award in 2007, the Marvin Miller Man of the Year Award. He's helped found Kings Ridge, the school, and I think more than anything, just being here tonight speaks of his heart and reaching out into this community and being here to help us with this. And so, you will, John Smoltz.
Well, thank you, and I'm overwhelmed with the turnout because when I thought about coming here to speak, when I tell you a little bit about myself, you realize why I'm not the one you really want to hear from an expertise standpoint, but from an educational standpoint and from a care for kids and the fact that so much can be done, this is a great stepping stone for a lot of you who are searching for answers, questions that you have and don't know where to turn. For me personally, I have, as for my whole life, I've been competing in sports ever since I was 7 years old. Didn't quite start out that way when I was four. I was competing with the accordion when I was four. Sports was not always something that was in our family. Music was. So I started as an accordion player, just to give you a brief background of kind of what maybe makes me the way I was. But I did, for 3 years, play the accordion. And then sports was something I had a passion for at the age of seven. From seven to the age of 46, much like all of us, we have something we're passionate about, but we also have something that can probably lead us towards a borderline addiction in some fashion or some way. And for me, I guess you can say amongst some of those things, competition can be one of those addictions, because I had to compete my whole life in a professional standpoint, but I love to compete and I love to go to battle. And the one thing you have to hear tonight is that this is a battle. This is a battle that a lot of people, and I hope that when this evening concludes, will be a stepping stone to all of you or some of you being able to partake in this battle, to compete for our kids, to really go after what has really been a decline in not only character, but in our world and what is popular and what is hip and what is okay. We've really watered down everything, if you think about it, from sports, the game that I love, that I play, character, has been watered down. Drugs has come part in our game to compete, to cheat, to get an edge, to do whatever it takes. So for me, the person of John Smoltz, I've always been taught that character is the most important thing that you can have. Unfortunately, That goes pretty quickly with the kids and what they're dealing with today. I'm not the one to come up here and speak of which, when you think about this talk, I'm probably on a scale of 1 to 100, the farthest way from being able to deliver this speech. I'll tell you why. I am in one of those rare minorities, and one of those rare blessings that I can only think comes from God. I have never been in a compromising situation my entire life. I'm 46 years old. I played with probably 150 to 200 different players over the 21 years of baseball. The pressures that we had and the pressures that were in that game were great. They're getting greater. But I've never been offered a drug. I couldn't tell you what anything is if you laid it on this table and explained what it was other than seeing on TV or hearing. But that is that's a blessing, because that can't happen anymore. It's probably in the less than 2% of the minority. When you think about what our kids are dealing with today and what they're in front of, I still can't believe it's never been proposed to me in my entire life. Now, part of that is by an intuition and an opportunity to try to stay away from that. But that other part is that blessing that I'm telling you about, that is just a freak, because my eighth grader, which is my youngest, probably knows more than I could ever imagine about what's going on in today's world. Unfortunately, as parents, we want to control the environment, but we probably have less time with our kids than we really think. And what they see, hear, smell, and feel is giving them things that we could never prepare them for or want them to be involved with. That's why it's so amazing when you think about an eighth grader, and you could probably go, and these people who are experts will tell you much more information, that they've been exposed to things that in 46 years of my life, I've never been exposed to. And I probably had the highest risk, or one of the higher risks, to be exposed in the arena that I played. So I too want to battle for my kids, I want to battle for other people's kids, and teach them a way and provide a way that gives them knowledge and hope, because identity is built and is in so many things that's what these kids are hoping for. That identity that they can be cool, or that they can be in this arena or that arena, is actually taking them over, and that addiction, and of course the chances of each individual and how they react based on the usage is not fair. Drugs is not fair. All the things that we see on TV is not fair. It's not, they don't play nice. It's not equal. Someone doesn't get 10 chances, someone gets one. Someone might get a lot more opportunities. And in my quest as a baseball player, that because that's what I became known for, whether it's my baseball camps, every step along the way, you almost see this, yeah, don't take drugs, don't do this, don't do that message. And it's been such a leverage situation that we have compromised so much because we think, well, what, it can't happen to our household, or it won't happen to my kids, or my kids are in a safe place. This town, this city, probably is not one of those cities we would think drugs would take place. We kind of categorize or stereotype where drugs are. Drugs has no face, has no color, has no race. That anything that they can do to get in the hands of a kid or a person, it's amazing. So for me to stand up here and to kick this off, it's an honor, but I also feel helpless in the sense that my knowledge is zero. I've been blessed to be protected, and I would do anything to protect my kids. But apart from my house, and apart from TV and movies, which we know what they're selling in every movie or TV program today, it's getting worse. What your kids are seeing, what's going into their brain, and what's going into their body is getting worse and worse and worse. Somebody said we're the most directly connected technical world we've ever been in. We're probably the most socially disconnected world we've ever been as well. Because there are so many things to take our kids away from, pure and good things. The technology has basically taken over. And that knowledge system, and that ability for a kid to know which pocket, which circle they can go to get X, Y, and Z is unbelievable. And the pressure to stay quiet and not help or not say a word, that's what I hope this evening can become. Because the information that you will get and the opportunity that you will have to help somebody and save a life, no matter if you ruin a friendship or a relationship, saving a life is the most important thing. There's people in this room that have been affected far greater than I and my wife, although we have been affected in our family. And I don't know what faith and what you believe in. Trust me on this. This type situation will ruin anything you can imagine in your life. And having played and seen so many people have their careers cut short, have their marriages or their family, the stress that it's put on is unbelievable. So when I agreed to do this, I hoped that this turnout would be exactly that, so that you can really get the meat and potatoes from somebody, from the professors, from the people who have seen this, from the judge who sits in the courtroom who constantly is dealing with this epidemic, to a classroom, a teacher, and a principal who has to deal with this on a daily basis. I consider myself lucky. I consider myself fortunate, but I also consider myself at a disadvantage because I have no idea what's out there. I have no idea how and what these kids and why they're trying so many different things just to not feel whatever they're feeling at the given moment that they don't like. Happiness and joy certainly cannot come this way, and I think you all know that. So when I think about my life, it started at 4 and really my sports career started at 7. I never envisioned the amount of opportunities that I would have to make an impact through playing the game of baseball. Whether it's visiting families in the hospital or whether it's being able to share a short message like this. One thing I know, I didn't come up here to elevate myself or speak as if I'm better than anybody else, because at any given moment, something can happen that takes away the great opportunity that I've been given as a celebrity. Grace is an amazing thing. Don't deserve it in our faith. The one thing that I'm hopeful is that people can get a second and third chance. What we don't want and what we hope to avoid is that this epidemic keeps going quiet, dormant, underground. We've got to expose it. If there's any battle that's worth fighting for, if there's any competition to try to get in and compete for, it's compete for our kids in a world where they are so against the eight ball. There are so many more pressures they're dealing with today. It doesn't matter if you're in a private school or a public school. It has absolutely no boundaries. So for me, I'm privileged to come on behalf of some brave people who will speak to you, people who have been studying this, people who give you insight, step aside with you, put an arm around you, and know what you're going through and what you're feeling. My life radically changed this past year and a half because I had to go to those meetings, and I had to go to certain situations where I had no idea the pain that existed, and the stress and the heartbreak that it is to watch a child basically throw away their life, basically give up on all the things that we have at our fingertips, and it changed me 100%. I didn't want to go there, I didn't want to be there, and I didn't want to do anything because I felt this not only was awkward, I had no idea what was going on. Many of us cannot say we don't know anybody that hasn't been affected or been and dealt with this disease and this addiction. And it's been around me my whole life. I could pretty much pick the pockets and know who was doing what, but never was in that situation of compromise. So for me, I tell kids all the time, there are so many more other things to fight for. There are so many things that I'm hopeful that the minority of celebrity athletes, which, when I say minority, you don't have any attention put on the character-driven ones. You just see the freakish athletic ones that do great things, and then the ones that obviously don't make news for the right reason. But we're all into that, what have you done for me lately, and what can you do for me, and we'll kind of give up the character issue if that person's playing for our own team sports and doing well. I hope we can change a lot of things through this evening and through this night, but more importantly, I hope it changes your philosophy into not sit still, not to sit patiently, not to sit idle, but to be able to do something in your community, in your school, in your county, whatever it takes, because it's worth fighting for. It's not getting better. It's getting worse, and the opportunities for these kids to experience on things you can't even dream up is out there. It breaks my heart, it breaks obviously a lot of people's hearts to see these kids go in the direction they are. I'm over my skis, I don't know what I'm talking about in this area, but I felt compelled to come here and at least share a small experience to kick off this event to say, I care, and character should matter. And the fight that we're in is a great fight. It's never gonna end. You don't know to the degree until you take time to invest in your children's lives and what's going on to help them protect against themselves. Because the people that are around them and the sphere of influence that they're around is so ever-consuming, it's gonna cause them to do something that might take their life. It's gonna cause them to make a tough decision that hopefully they'll get a chance to make up for and be able to tell and share their stories. So thank you for coming out on a weeknight. Thank you for being able to listen to some great stories of wisdom and hopefully some stories of answers. Thank you very much.
Duane Piper, I'm sure Forsyth can. I want to echo the gratitude for the turnout. I don't think I've seen any other event that's drawn this many people to the Senate. It means a lot. Last thing that I want to do at the very beginning of hibernation season is sit at the table and listen to somebody tell me a bunch of numbers. And I have to do that a little bit to illustrate a point. There's a reason for these numbers. This type of meeting, this type of intercourse is long overdue and needs to continue. So I'm going to have to use some statistics. Just stay with me. We'll lay down the table, go to bed. Hopefully at the end you'll understand why I presented these statistics. We've used some information that has not been presented to you before, I'm sure, and I know it's not been presented to you in the way that Jeff presented it. It's my strong belief that this information not being presented to parents and students is the reason that it's necessary to have a meeting like this. Traffic fatalities. For our young people, 21 and under, the last 8 years, from the year 2006, the beginning of 2006, to the present time, about 8 years, we've had 14 traffic fatalities in Forsyth County. 14 of our young folks have died driving. That's, I'm not a mathematician, but that's a little bit under two per year. Three of them involved alcohol. One of those alcohol also was drugs and alcohol together, and the other was drugs alone. That's four. Four of 14. Of our traffic fatalities of young people have only been four of them involving drugs and alcohol. The vast majority were not. Right now you should be asking yourself, we're in drug something. Why do I have the sheriff up here talking about traffic fatalities? That'll become clear in just a minute. Are we inadvertently sending the wrong message to our children is one of the things I want to get across. We've done a good job of not letting our kids drink and drive. We tell our kids not to drink if they're going to be driving, not to do drugs if they're going to be driving. Well, obviously we've done a pretty good job with that. But in sending that message, are we telling them that drugs might be okay as long as you're not driving? It's just a question. It's something to think about. In the past 2 years, 2012 and 2013, we've had 19 drug overdoses in Forsyth County. Compare that. I want you to get the significance of that number. Over an 8-year period, we've lost 14 of our young children to traffic accidents. When one of our young ones dies in a traffic accident, you see that on TV for 2 or 3 days. In 2 years, we've lost 19 to drug overdoses. I haven't seen the first story on it in media. I think this goes with what Mr. Smoltz was talking about. Is it something we're not talking about? If it's something we're not talking about, we live in a wonderful community up here. Forsyth County is blessed in so many ways. We have to respond to the blessings by talking to our kids. Let me explain to you real quick what I'm talking about. You hear me using the word opiates. When I refer to opiates, largely I'm talking about heroin specifically. But also in there, the time constraints, I'm not going to be able to get a big class on this. But time constraints, that's also going to include methadone, oxycodone, oxycontin, synthetic opiates. I'm going to group them all together for the purpose of this. I'll answer more questions when we get to the question and answer part of it. But of the 19 deaths we've had, 13 of them are confirmed, medically confirmed, opiate overdoses in Forsyth County. Again, we've lost 14 of our young ones to traffic fatalities, but we've lost 13 to opiates. This number will be significant a little bit later. 12 of those deaths occurred in 2012, 7 of them so far this year in 2013. We've been arresting your kids. Some of y'all know it. Some of y'all have experienced it. Some of y'all know people who have been arrested. This year alone, 2013, are heroin specific. I'm not including other opiates. Heroin alone. The arrests have gone up 5 times what they were just last year in 2012. 5 times. The total weight that we see to these arrests is over double from what we see last year. Total drug arrests, we're on pace to just about exactly double what we made last year. When you look at those numbers, I'm done giving the numbers, by the way. I might throw some more in, but I just want to talk to you about what's going on. When you look at those numbers, at first blush, you might take those numbers and say, well, if we arrest any more kids and few of them are dying from drug overdoses, there's your answer. Let's put them in jail, it's saving their lives. That would be bad, that would be a misuse of information. That's not the answer. Is it possible that it's true? It might be. But it would definitely be temporary. I'm not satisfied with a possible or temporary solution. The solution is getting involved with our kids. The solution is getting to know your kids. I'm going to do my best not to start preaching. I don't want to step on anything anybody else has got to talk about. You're probably going to hear something about watching your kids. Watching them. Are they moody? Are they withdrawn? Are their eating habits changing? We're talking about teenagers, right? They're all like that. That's where it's on us as parents. Get to know your kids. Spend time with them. Know if it's just the teenage moodiness. Know if it's just the teenage withdrawal, or if there's something else going on in their life. Get in their business. Their business, by definition, is your business. It's heartbreaking when we arrest your kids. I wouldn't try to minimize the heartbreak of families and loved ones that go through the pain of drug addiction by saying that we were just as heartbroken. We can't be. We can't know the pain that you're going through. It's different from the pain that anybody else is going through in the same situation. But it breaks our heart. It doesn't make us feel good to put them in jail. And that's not the answer. Sitting next to a Hall of Famer. A lot of y'all came to hear him talk, so I'm using baseball analogy. I'm going on the premise that y'all understand baseball. If your kids come into contact with law enforcement or the legal system because of drug use or because of their contact with drugs, that's not the beginning. That's the end. That's the equivalent in baseball terms of being top of the ninth inning. You're 10 runs down. You used every pitcher you got. And your second baseman is pitching. You're praying for miracles. That is the only thing that's going to save your child or your family. And miracles are happening every day. Treatment providers, the things that they're doing, are treatment courts, outstanding. They are miracles. But we need to stop it before that. We need to get involved in the first day. The first and second, when you're figuring out what's going on with the game. Who can play? What's going on? That's where we got to get involved. That's where we've got to be with our kids. That's where we've got to know what they're doing, who they're doing it with, and what they're doing on the internet. This information is not intended to overwhelm or depress in any way. To be sure, the number of arrests for opiates, that'd be heroin and all the rest of them, group them together again, are a very small percentage of the drug arrests. But there's no way to escape the fact that we make five times as many in a one-year jump. We can't escape that. That is a problem in our community. It needs to be addressed. Thank y'all for coming. This is overwhelming. It's heartening, and it's a good sign to see this many people that are disinterested in what's going on in their community and their kids. We as law enforcement sometimes are separated by all we do is arrest people, all we do is the bad things. For me, to any one of my deputies, if you have a problem going on in your family that you need help with, you talk to us. We'll point you to the resources. We'll show you where you need to go. We'll show you who can help you with this. This is a community. We're part of this community, and we're going to help you succeed. Thank you.
I'm Jeff Bagley. I'm your Chief Superior Court Judge here in this judicial circuit. I also am the presiding judge of the Southland Drug Court, which I'm very proud of. That's what I'm going to be talking to you mainly about this evening. I'd like to thank Commissioner Mills for inviting me to this wonderful event. I'm too astounded at the turnout that we said. I didn't really know what to expect. It's just amazing how many people are interested in the subject. And I know that Commissioner Mills is interested. I think her heart's in the right place. She has actually attended at least two of our drug court graduation ceremonies here in Forsyth County. So I know that she is really has a passion for this subject. I know that most everyone in here has probably, in some way, either directly or indirectly, been impacted because of drugs and alcohol. And your presence here this evening shows your concern for what I will call an epidemic that we have seen and we continue to see here in our county, state, and our nation in this year. Untold millions suffer daily and billions of dollars are spent on the care for substance abusers, not to mention the social toll that drug and alcohol abuse takes on our society in the form of family violence cases that I see on a daily basis, broken homes, divorces, which I also preside over, domestic relations cases. So pretty much daily in the court system, we see the effects and the toll that the use and abuse of drugs and alcohol takes on our society and on our population. Many times in order to save their loved ones, families will spend lots of money to send a child or a relative to a rehab center, only to learn that after the expenditure of a good portion of their life savings, that person actually returns to using in a pretty short period of time. What a disappointment it has to be for those family members who are trying to get their loved one out of the grip of the disease of alcohol and drugs. I've heard these stories time and again from my drug court participants who tell me that without the intervention of the court system, that they would be dead, that drug court has actually saved their lives. Many have been through several rehab facilities, but drug court is the only thing that has worked for them. The Forsyth County Drug Court will celebrate its 10th anniversary in January of 2014. Since its inception 10 years ago, we have graduated 236 persons. To our knowledge, and we don't know, we can't get an exact number on this because obviously people move to different states and so forth sometimes, but to our knowledge, approximately 32 people out of those 236 graduates have been rearrested. And that's not all for drugs, but that's the rearrest number that we have. That's about a 13% recidivism rate, which is a far cry from the 75% recidivism rate for individuals who are released from the state prison system after I've sentenced an offender to a prison term. Drug court, you wonder what it is. What is this thing that Judge Bagley is talking about? Well, drug court is a division of the Superior Court, wherein certain felony cases are referred to the drug court program by the district attorney of this circuit, Ms. Penny Penn, and she's on our staff, our drug court staff. Stand up, Ms. Penn. I want everybody to see you. You're an integral part of our drug court, and also another integral part of our drug court is our accountability court's director for Forsyth County, that's Jennifer Johnston. I want Jennifer to stand up. I'm ordering you to stand up, Ms. Johnston. And so we have that they are an integral part of our drug court team. We call it a team because we get together, we have staffing every Tuesday afternoon at 1:30, and I hold drug court. In fact, I came from drug court. We finished up about a little after 6 o'clock this evening in time for me to get here to speak to you all. Drug court is an alternative to traditional sentencing, which allows an individual who elects to come into the program a chance to become clean and sober. And as an added incentive, in certain cases, the state will ultimately dismiss the charges upon their graduation after a minimum period of 2 years. In other cases, where it's appropriate, probation, their probation is terminated early and the person can be discharged from their the crime. Regardless of whatever legal benefit they receive from completing and graduating from the program, the most valuable benefit by far is a life of sobriety. I told three individuals who were accepted into our program this evening that that is the biggest benefit that they're going to get, is that they will become a productive member of this community. They'll become someone who is trusted, working, and contributing rather than being a drain on the community in the jails or in the prisons. And that is by far the biggest benefit that they can get. Why does drug court work when so many voluntary rehab programs fail? That may be the question you may be asking. There's a phrase in the field that we call coerced treatment. Put simply, most of you probably have heard the old adage, you can lead a horse to water, but you can't make him drink. Well, in drug court, we can make them drink, figuratively. The threat of sanctions, primarily jail sanctions, and the threat of termination and sentencing and potentially prison is enough to force most participants to comply just long enough to begin to embrace the new lifestyle of sobriety, so much so that it actually will stick with them. I serve on the board of the National Association of Drug Court Professionals, which is a national organization of drug court professionals, and the symbol of our organization is a serpent which is wrapped around the gavel. This represents the melding of the legal profession, represented by the gavel, and the medical profession, represented by the serpent, in a way that has never really been done before. By combining intensive judicial supervision, in most cases weekly, a weekly visit to the court by the participant, with drug testing, intensive drug testing, random and observed, and intensive counseling by medical professionals, we can achieve the goal of changing lives, and in many cases, saving lives. The drugs we have seen have changed over the years, as the sheriff has said. In the 2000s, I saw was methamphetamine was the primary drug that we were seeing. Now, in addition to methamphetamine, we're seeing an influx of prescription opiates, advancing to heroin as being the predominant drug of choice in many cases. Our population seems to be younger as well, with most of our participants under the age of 35, many in their early 20s, and a few in their late teens. And yes, an adult in Georgia is 17 years old. Not so that when they're 17 and they are arrested by Sheriff Piper's people, they don't go to juvenile court anymore. Judge Jackson's here, he's gonna speak in a moment. They come to Superior Court. And yes, we've got a few teenagers. I've got one of our drug court participants who is in the school system here in Forsyth County as a teenager. So yes, they are that young. I would also like to recognize State Court Judge Russ McClellan, who presides over the Forsyth County DUI Court, which is also very successful for DUI offenders. So Judge McClellan, I'm going to order you to stand up too. Thank you for being here. And also, I have spearheaded the establishment of a mental health court for Forsyth County through procurement of some state grant funding, which we've been lucky enough to be the recipient of, both for our drug courts and DUI courts and mental health court. And State Court Judge Leslie Abernathy Maddox has agreed to sit for me as Superior Court Judge to preside over that division of Superior Court, being mental health court. And she's also committed to start a misdemeanor drug court for marijuana cases that will be prosecuted in State Court of Forsyth County. Judge Abernathy Maddox, stand up. I want to see you. Every Tuesday, I would be remiss if I didn't say also that with these accountability courts, we have to have, as I said, the cooperation of the prosecutors. I've already introduced Ms. Penn as a district attorney. The prosecutor for the State Court of Forsyth County also has to cooperate in this endeavor for its work. And Solicitor General Donna Gopal, who's standing up over there in the T-shirt, she is cooperating, of course, with the State Court, accountability courts, DUI court, and the misdemeanor drug court. So we appreciate her participation. Every Tuesday afternoon, our staff meets. We discuss the progress of each one of our individuals. We have about 80 to 90 participants in our program. I then hold court and determine whether sanctions or incentives are warranted. Many people this afternoon I had to send to jail for a sanction. They tested positive, they had positive screens, and some I gave some incentives to. I gave some praise from the bench, things of that nature also as incentives. I get to know these people, and I will tell you that they are real people who have found themselves on the wrong side of the law, but who are suffering and who are in need. Drug court is a way to lend a hand to our fellow man. And when we have the ability to do so, I believe that if we fail to act as public servants, we have missed the golden opportunity to serve. And it has been my privilege and my honor to preside over the drug court in Forsyth County these last 10 years. And really, it's been one of the most worthwhile and rewarding things that I've ever done as a Superior Court judge. And I will leave this one thought with you. Drug courts work. Thank you for having me this evening, and God bless you all.
I am Russell Jackson, and I am the judge of the juvenile court in Forsyth County. And I, too, am astounded to see so many people here this evening. But I commend you all for being here. And the message that I want to send to you is that parents and other guardians of children, whether they be grandparents involved in those children's lives, extended family members, mentors, coaches, you have power. You have the most power of any of us sitting up here in your children's lives. And I have to say this, I'm astounded that I have to say this so often while I'm sitting in court, many times with a whole family sitting in front of me, a young person, a mother, a father, if we're lucky, all sitting there, and I have to tell those parents, you have the power here. You've all heard the saying, parents are the best anti-drug. Well, it is true. You spend more time with your child and your children than any of us will ever spend. And I have to echo what Sheriff Pfeiffer said. Knowing those children and communicating with them is the key to that. So take on the mantle that you have. You have real power. And don't be afraid to use it and exercise it. Your child owns no property. Your child has no privacy. Legally, nothing. They live in your house. They probably drive your car or the car that you provided for them. They don't own anything. You own it and you let them use it. The room that they have in your house is your room. Don't listen to any of this gobbledygook about, I have a constitutional right to privacy. You can't come into my room and say, that's not right. You understand? We have to tell people this. But I believe that people do, because of our society and all the media and, you know, all the concerns about everybody else that has a say-so in your child's life, the fear, you know, that social services or Department of Family and Children's Services will be called, all those kinds of things. I think some people use that as an excuse not to do anything, but you, as parents of children, guardians of children, you do have the power, and that's what I try to do, and we try to do in juvenile court, is we try to empower parents to do their job. I don't want to parent your children when they come in front of me. That's not my job. But I will support parents in doing that job. The mission of the juvenile court is not to have your children arrested and prosecuted and convicted and sent to juvenile detention and have records for the rest of their life. The stated mission of the juvenile court is to treat and rehabilitate young people and turn them into, hopefully, productive members of society, productive adults, well-rounded adults. That's your job as a parent as well. And we are here to try to help you in that mission if you need help. Some of the ways that we can help you is first to assure you, as I said, that the goal is not to put your children in danger, not to punish your children, even. Although, as I often say, unfortunately, punishment is a part of rehabilitation. If you don't understand that there are consequences for your actions, you don't learn that lesson as a young person, then you miss a huge lesson that you need to learn in your life. But that is not the primary goal, to punish, as it is sometimes in the adult system. We just want to punish people for being bad people. We want to remove them from society altogether so they're not a danger to any of the rest of us. That is not the goal in juvenile court. Our goal is to figure out what the problems are and to help everybody come together and everybody help solve those problems. So, as Sheriff Piper said, do not be afraid to call on people in the legal community, even in the law enforcement community, because they're all interested. And I've been around doing this for a long time, and I can tell you one thing that most all people are interested in is helping young people and lending a hand to a family who really wants it and is in need. And if you call us at juvenile court, and you as parents, again, have power, you don't have to wait for law enforcement to show up and arrest your kids. You can file a complaint on them yourself in juvenile court and ask for help. What ways can we help? As Judge Bagley mentioned, intensive drug screening. That is a very good way, you think your kids are using drugs, to get people to stop using drugs. If they know they're going to get caught when they use, I guarantee you they're a lot less likely to use. And if they know they've got random screens coming at any time, then that's a good way that they're going to get caught. And they learn that very fast. But there are many other programs that we have, ability to support you, help you enforce the rules, monitor your children, GPS monitors. We have all kinds of tools that we can employ to assist you in parenting your children. We also have a juvenile accountability and substance abuse court, basically a drug court for young people. And that is a very effective tool as well. It's hard on the whole family. It's not for everybody necessarily, because in our court, whatever the kids have to do, now to hear this complaint from parents. It's, I feel like that as a parent, I'm on probation instead of my kid, because everything the kid has to do is required to do. The parent has to be right there, driving them around, making sure they're going where they're supposed to be, meeting with the probation officers with them. And it's the same thing in our drug court, because I know from experience that if we don't change the whole family environment, we're not going to be successful in changing that child's behavior. And sometimes it takes that intensive work with the entire family to make those changes. We have a lot of services that we can offer to you. And once we are through with your case, with your child, hopefully what we will be able to do, even though they may have come to court, they may have been what we call adjudicated delinquent, that's not a conviction. The law says they haven't been convicted of a crime. They've been adjudicated as a delinquent. Recognizing children are different. They're going to make mistakes. We're going to give them the chance to rebound from those mistakes without being marked for the rest of their lives. But we'll go further than that. If your child does well, we can terminate their case successfully because they've been rehabilitated, then the law allows you also to come back and ask that your record, your juvenile record, even be completely sealed and expunged. So it'll be, and the law says if that happens, it's to be treated as if the whole thing never even occurred. It's like a bad dream. So don't be afraid to ask for help. We have a whole new category of children, classification of children we're going to be dealing with in January 1 that the legislature created for us that further emphasizes this idea. And that category of children is going to be called children in need of services. And that could be a child who's just unruly, who could be using drugs, who's running away from home, who's truant from school, or just needs help. And the whole family needs help. So again, it's not just our court, it's the whole system that is going toward this idea of let's treat children as children, recognize they make mistakes, try to rehabilitate them, provide them the treatment they need, and hopefully they never end up in Judge Bagley's court. Although I send every child that comes through my drug court, I make them go sit not only in Judge Bagley's adult drug court saying, you know, now's the time to change, because when you get up there, Judge Bagley's not soft like I am. He'll lock you up and send you to jail in 2 seconds. Also send every kid, once they reach phase three, the upper level phase of my drug court program, I send them to Judge McClellan's DUI court as well to send the same message. It's not just drugs, people, it's alcohol too. And don't be fooled by marijuana and think, well, my kids just use marijuana. I use marijuana, it's not a big deal. No. Marijuana is a powerful mind-altering drug. Studies show that the marijuana that is out there today may be 12 and more times more potent and more powerful than what was around in the 60s or the 70s. They've bred new strains. And you don't know what's in marijuana when your child is smoking it. And I found this time and time again, because we'll test a child and they'll come up positive for a whole host of things, and they'll say, I swear I didn't do anything to smoke marijuana. It was because other drugs got mixed up. These are not regulated stuff. Other drugs got mixed up in the marijuana, and they ended up smoking heroin and methamphetamine and, you know, whatever else might have been lying around that was cut into that particular batch of marijuana. Or somebody did it on purpose and gave it to them. Whatever the reason, it's not regulated. And where does it act on? The frontal lobe of the brain, the part of the brain in the adolescent that's still forming. Powerful mind-altering substance. I tell kids all the time, what are you going to do? End up brain damaged for the rest of your life because you smoke marijuana? That's what potentially could happen. So don't say, my kid's just smoking marijuana, no big deal. My kid's just drinking alcohol, no big deal. Guarantee you it's a big deal, because that's where it starts, and where it ends up is in Judge Bagley's court, Judge McClellan's court, Judge Abernathy Maddox's court. So do something while you can do something. Don't be afraid to do something. We have flyers in the back about our accountability and substance use court program, as well as our contact information. There are many ways besides just drug court program we can try to help you, and we are here to serve you in any way we can. but be empowered as parents. That's the message I would like you to take away. And again, thank you all for being here tonight.
Good evening. My name is Brad Baker. First of all, I'd like to thank everybody for coming out tonight. When we first sat down and talked about this, we had no idea the numbers we were going to get. And it's just amazing to see all the families that have come out. I'm the founder and the CEO of a group called the Bradley Intervention Center. We work with families whose loved ones are struggling with drugs or alcohol or behavioral issues. Our mission is to work with them to provide opportunities to get help, to hold them accountable, and to also provide assistance to the families. Because the families are going through this just as much as the children are. And if the families don't know how to help them without enabling them, if they don't know how to provide for them without giving to them, and if they don't know how to support them without grounding them, it doesn't work. Tonight I wanted to just spend a little bit of time talking to the parents about some of the things that we see, some of the things people in my group see that have been the roadblocks and the obstacles that they first have to overcome. We call it the four stages. Because let's face it, nobody really wakes up in the morning and says, you know what, my son's an addict, let's have an intervention. Because that doesn't work. You have to go through and really decide, what is it? Are you willing to make this commitment for somebody to go to treatment? Because it's not 28 and done. That doesn't work, people. It's a commitment on behalf of the family and all those who support the family before you do anything. But most of the time when we get in front of families, we go through some stages with them. And the first stage is always denial. And you've heard it already tonight. It's not my son or daughter. It's not my community. It's not going to happen here. And I'm telling you, it is happening here. In the last 3 months, myself and other people who work in my group and in other groups have worked with at least 20 families. And the majority of them have been either alcohol or heroin. So if you think it's not your child, or it's not in our community, I'm standing here to tell you, it could be your child. And it is in our community. The next thing that we hear is usually reasoning. Reasoning of, well, it's only pot. And as you just heard from the judge, today's pot is not your dad's pot. Today's pot has got stuff in it that you don't even know about. The synthetic pot that they're making, the pot that's mixed, that's cut. Drug dealer has this much pot and he needs some extra money, so he cuts it and fills it with this. It's not just pot anymore. Most people that we work with, the young adults or the adolescents, always tell us, at some point, I was introduced to pot. They also tell us, at some point, I was introduced to alcohol. A state of Georgia study that came out showed that the students said the average age of starting to drink was 13 and a half. So if you think, well, it's okay, it's just alcohol, and they're doing it in my home, so it's safe, I know they're not out on the roads. Alcohol and pot are leading our kids down the path. And that path right now is going to meth, painkillers, opiates, heroin. And nobody can believe where these kids are getting it. We live in Forsyth County, it shouldn't be here. They're getting it from your medicine cabinets. They're getting it from your refrigerators that are in your garages. It's all around us. But parents, are still in that phase of reasoning. It'll be okay. If I just get them off to college, everything will be all right. My son's over there and I'm saying the same thing. But here's the problem. You have a child who's struggling with drugs or alcohol, or a behavioral issue, who's cutting, who's had something traumatic happen in their life, and they're using. And you're saying if I send them away someplace where there's less structure, less accountability, and more freedom, everything's going to be just fine. Parents who engage in my service that have kids that are in college always said, I wish I would have done something when they were younger, when I could do something. Most of you here today are still at that stage. Some of you, you know, both ways. But you have to realize there's always something to do. Which brings us to our control phase. Taking away iPads and cars doesn't do it. Knowing where your child is going. When they say they're going to a party and spending the night at somebody's house, figure out if the parents know about it. Figure out if the parents know that kids are bringing water bottles full of vodka through the back door in backpacks. Figure out if the kids are leaving and going out in the woods and smoking pot and then coming back. Get engaged, get involved, be in the know, because they're your kids. The more you push them, and the more you try to put control and curfews, the more they'll push back on you. You're feeding the train, and you're just feeding it and feeding it, and finally that train is going to run off the track. So then you come to the health piece, and here's where it takes a community. People say all the time, I didn't know who to talk to. I didn't know where to turn to. I didn't know where to get help. There's people sitting up here that you'll hear from later that'll tell you that. There's people sitting out here in the audience that I personally know that will tell you that. There's resources out there. You can call me. You can call the sheriff, you can call the judge, you can call the panel up here, you can call Cindy, you can call people, you can call John Smoltz if you get some. If you do, give it to me. There's resources out there. And what we're trying to do is we're trying to build a community that will no longer worry about the stigma of substance abuse and addiction. That will no longer worry about going to Sharon Springs baseball field or West Forsyth baseball field and say, oh, there goes that lady, her son's an addict. But it still will go up and say, how are you doing? What's going on with your son? How can we help? We need to change our mindset here. So, in closing, again, I want to thank you for coming. But I also want to make a statement and a challenge to you. My statement is that I can't tell you again how many times I work with families and they say, I just didn't know. This is a great community and we've got a great opportunity. So my challenge for you is when you leave this building, I want you to commit to me that you'll be the one. That you'll be the one that will talk to your neighbors. That you'll be the one that will talk to people at school, to your families, to people at church, people at work, that you'll be the one that will stand up and say, guys, there's a problem, let's do something about it. Again, if you don't have the answers, that's fine. We have the answers. There's therapists all throughout this county that have ways to work on the answers. But we need you to be the one to take the stand for our community and to step up and say, this isn't going to happen any longer. Thank you, Douglas.
Well, Brad just told my story, so I can probably sit down. We were one of those parents that had no idea what was going on. First, I want to say thank you, especially to Cindy Mills, to the school board, and to our new sheriff, who is amazing. If you haven't met him, please say hello. They really are the reason that we're here. We've had struggles with our kids for some time, and wanted something to be done in the county and just were unable to get anything started until now. So this really is all them. A lot of counties around us have the same problem. This is not a Forsyth County problem, but I have not seen the other counties pulling together coalitions like this. So we are blessed to be in this county. We are blessed to be in a small enough county that's run by people that really care and have some really good programs to offer, that they're all gonna work together. But they need a lot of help, and that's what they're asking for tonight from you. This is a community effort. We heard, we've been spreading the word about this meeting tonight, and my husband heard someone say, well, it's not really a school problem. Well, it's not a school problem, but your kids are at school longer during the day than you see them. And if they have sports after school, you really don't see them as much as their peers do. So we really need everyone involved to be able to help. It's not that this is the school's problem, and I'm sure Buster will attest to that, but everyone needs to be involved for a solution. I'm Sherry Ajluni, and I'm a Forsyth County parent. My husband and I have 6 children. We know all too well about the influence of drugs in our children's lives. Our 2 oldest boys started using marijuana and alcohol in high school. We were very involved in their lives. My husband coached them. We tried to stay on top of where they were. We attended every game or activity they ever did. We raised them in church. We tried to do the right things. We talked openly about drugs as much as we knew, which honestly was very little. And we talked about sex, and honestly, I was more worried about them having sex than drugs. That was just never really on my radar. We had 0 tolerance for drugs. We tried to control their behavior even more so when we found out they were using. But all kids are not just experimenting. When you find your kid smoking pot and you think this is just a phase, I did this when I was young, they are not all just experimenting. And we found that out with our own kids. 1 in 4, about 25% of us, has a tendency towards addiction. That's a lot. 1 in 4 of us. Look how many people are in this room. 1 in 4 of us is an addict. Most people have addiction somewhere in their family tree. Look back at your parents, your grandparents, generations, aunts, uncles. There's probably more alcoholics than drug addicts, but that's quickly changing now. It's just like allergies. You don't know you have allergies until you're exposed to what you're allergic to. That's how drug addiction works. You don't know you're an addict until you start using drugs or alcohol. Addicts react differently to drugs or alcohol than non-addicts. Their high is much different than a non-addict. They get addicted much faster. And so no matter what we tried to do, our 2 boys continued to experiment with harder drugs until we discovered in 2007 that they were using heroin. Our 2 babies that were afraid of blood tests were using heroin. We caught the kids looking messed up, and they kept saying they were just smoking pot. We knew better, but we had no idea what it was. Luckily, I was working with a nurse at the time that started talking about how she knew her nephew was using opiates because his eyes were pinpointed. And I went home and told my husband, that's what our kids' eyes look like. So of course, we're instantly looking up opiates. What are they? Didn't even know that much. Found out they were painkillers, which of course the kids said they were just taking pills at the time, because addicts like to downplay whatever they really are doing. We took them to a counselor, not knowing where to turn. The counselor agreed to help them. He should not have. He should have said, this is way above my pay grade, but he didn't. So they continued to use. Later that year, they went to their first of several drug rehab centers. They were in and out of rehab for years. I can't even describe the devastation to your family that's caused when your child has this disease. Lots of families deal with children with other diseases, and it's similar to that, where that diseased person gets more attention, except that most diseases are not brought on by our own bad choices and actions, and this one is. So the entire family is angry. Their siblings are angry, the parents are angry, the entire family becomes sick. You look around at your neighbors and friends and you think, why are we the only ones with issues? What you don't know is how many of us there really are. It's just that no one is talking. You get resentful. You can't plan a family vacation. You can't plan anything because you don't know what's coming next or where they'll end up, whether they'll be in rehab or not, whether they'll be visiting Judge Jackson, who we know. He may not remember me, but I remember him. And he's very good. They've stolen from you. They'll rob you blind, your own children. It's amazing. And so you really don't have the money for vacation anyways. There goes the college money, and you begin to mourn. You go through like the stages of grief. You mourn for their youth, that they're wasting when they should be having fun and graduating from high school. You lose hope that they'll ever get out of this, and you forget what normal even is. You see it in your neighbors, but it's not in your house at all. Your dreams slowly disappear. You spend way too much time trying to save them and not enough time living for yourself. You're immobilized. Your goal becomes to save them. Our boys lived on the streets, they stole, they lied, they went to jail, which sometimes you're like, thank God, because they're safe. Those are like the only nights I could sleep, is if somebody was in jail. These are middle class kids choosing to live on the streets rather than at home because of this addiction. This was unbelievable to us. I'm generally a very positive, glass half full kind of person, but this is, I've never felt so alone or depressed in my entire life. I couldn't sleep. I tensed up every time the phone rang, especially at night. You're waiting for that call that your babies are never coming home. I lived in shame and guilt for anything wrong I ever said or did. What did we do wrong? I was afraid to tell people because I thought they would think it was our fault. We went through this for 4 years. In 2010, Brandon had been through yet another rehab. He did well, graduated from it, and one of the few times he actually finished, and he went on to college. He wanted to be a high school history teacher and a coach. He wanted to help keep kids off of drugs. He talked about having a prevention program in the county. He wanted to come back here and work. Things were finally getting better, and we even dared to be hopeful again. He was going to school year round. He came home for the 4th of July break that night, that summer. I noticed he looked thin. He said he was just riding his bike a lot, and then he would start eating more to make up for it. I was worried, but thought maybe I was just being paranoid. He went back to school and shortly thereafter was arrested for shoplifting. He had been in trouble before, so this time he knew he was going to jail for a long time. I got a call from the college saying Brandon was missing. I spent 3 days looking for him with detectives. On the third day, someone found him. When I got the call to quit looking and come back to college, I knew he wasn't found alive. He had taken his life. He left a note saying that he just didn't want to hurt us anymore, and he didn't want to live in the hell he had created for himself. There's no explanation for the amount of grief you feel when you lose a child. I don't even remember much of the first few months. You literally can't function. When people say your heart breaks, that phrase is because your chest hurts for months. You feel like you're having a heart attack for months. You can't sleep. You can't take a full breath. I honestly didn't want to live. I prayed for God to take me, and I'm sure I'm not alone with other parents that have lost children. I pray you never experience any of this, and that's why I'm here telling you my story. And I do agree. Thank you, but you're not done with me. I know you're all here to find out how you cannot end up like me, and I want to help you prevent this with your children, your neighbor, or whoever you come in contact with. So how do you prevent drug abuse? First, stop thinking this will never happen to you. You've heard that tonight repeatedly. Stop thinking that. Acknowledge that you have alcoholics and other addicts in your family. This is proven to be a disease. It's hereditary, and it's possible for anyone. Understand that drugs are now easier to get for your children than alcohol. Overdose is now the leading cause of death among young people. You heard that tonight, I think. He's talking about car accidents. He's talking about our county, Sheriff Piper. This is nationally. This isn't just our county. Overdose is the leading cause of death. In our county, there have been 33 911 calls regarding overdose year to date. There have been at least 15 deaths this year to overdose in the county. Get educated. We didn't see the signs early. We didn't know what to look for. We wrote it off as craziness of teens. You know, everything was just normal and hormonal. It's not all. Go to a class, read online, know more than your kids do. Your kids are way smarter than you, or at least they think they are. They're looking online, but they're looking in the wrong places. Go get the right information so you can talk to them about what those drugs they're taking are really doing to their brain, how their brain is not developed until they're 25, and how they're stunting their growth. Start talking early. Start at least in middle school. Educate your kids on how one possession charge can disqualify them from college. If you don't have anyone going to college yet, when you fill out that application, it's going to ask you if you have ever been accused or convicted of drug abuse, drug possession, something like that. You have to check yes or lie if they've ever had a possession charge. Drug test them. We should have done this much, much earlier. And you don't have to pay for the $45 drug test at CVS. Go to homedrugtestingkit.com. Write that down. Drug tests are $10 for a 10-panel. Test them for everything. Even just have it sitting out in the house so that they know you have it. Maybe they'll be less likely to experiment. At least some kids will. Don't let your kids drink, and especially don't let other kids drink at home. Even if your child is not an addict, their friend may be. And you don't want to live knowing you got them started. Look for signs. Change in clothing, change in friends, sleeping in more, missing school, a general lack of motivation. Don't trust them. They're liars. They say they're going to be somewhere. You can even, I don't even trust all the other parents. You can call the parents. The parents may say, yes, they're going to be there, but they may still leave. We have GPS on their phones now. We didn't have that back then. Work together as a community, like you're doing tonight. Don't keep drug use a secret. If you think your child has a problem, ask for help right away. If you suspect another child has used, tell their parents. People ask me that all the time. Well, someone used, but I don't want to get involved in their life. I'm just going to stick to my own little world. No. Tell their parents. If something happens to that child and they overdose and you haven't said anything, you're living with that. Encourage your kids to be open with you and to tell teachers or parents if one of their friends is using. This is life or death. This is not gossip. This is when the kids need to be telling on each other. Drug users do not fit into a stereotype. They can be jocks, scholarly, artsy, whatever. We've been in a lot of parent groups. There's a lot of good parents out there with drug addicts. We've also had some of the cutest, most well-mannered, yes ma'am, kids at our house that were shooting heroin in the basement. So don't think that you can tell by looking at them that they're drug users. You cannot. The high school kids I've talked to in the county have told me the majority are using drugs or have used drugs. It crosses all income levels, all cliques, all areas of the county. These are good kids making bad choices. If you think your kids are using, get support. It's really tough to not enable them. You want to believe them, but trust me, they're lying. We're organizing a support group like Al-Anon, but just for parents. The first meeting is tomorrow night at 7. You should have information in your bags. If not, you can see me after. Get support. Get your life back and get resources. You need to work with other parents that are in the same boat. You're not alone and you're not a bad parent. This is a great community. We're blessed to have it. I want all of us to work together to change the stigma of drug use from everyone is doing it to why would you do it? I'm Sherry Ajluni, I'm the parent of a drug addict.
Good evening, everybody. My name is Daniel Krasner. My title is Clinical Solutions Provider. I work for a residential treatment program called the Ranch at Dovetree. And I'm kind of going to give you a brief synopsis on how I got there. I'm a drug addict. I'm in recovery. And I can promise you that like 8.5 years ago, nobody would let me speak up here with police officers right next to me. That's for sure. I'm from Marietta, Georgia. Grew up there, born 1987, 26 years old. I've been sober for 8.5 years. I come from what I thought was like a pretty normal family. I got a mom, a dad, two sisters, a brother. Both of my parents worked. I had kind of like a nanny growing up till my parents got home from work, then she'd go home. I felt like my home life was pretty much normal for the most part. Growing up, my parents were the type of parents who basically, in my eyes, like today, I still think they're perfect parents after everything that I've gone through and they've gone through. And I don't think that they did anything wrong as parents. I don't think they were equipped with the tools or knowledge to know what to do any differently. But growing up, my parents were the type of parents who, you know, attended field trips for school. They were always there for me at my sporting events, at my family's sporting events, at everything. And growing up for me, you know, playing hockey was one of the things that I liked to do. And going to school, hanging out with friends, playing sports, that sort of thing was fairly normal. I will say, like, when I was 7 years old, like, something happened with my sister where she developed an eating disorder and my family hid that from me and I didn't know what it was. And growing up, I always thought that, you know, there was something my sister, they told me it was from drinking coffee and I believed that because I didn't know any better as a young child. And kind of progressing through growing up, everything was really normal. For when I first started using drugs and alcohol, I was in ninth grade. I had no reason whatsoever to pick up a drug or drink or anything like that. And I had friends who were doing it, and I thought maybe it would be a good idea to try it with them. And I remember, you know, I smoked marijuana the first time Friday night, did not get high. I pretended like I was high. And then I went home and I sat in my mother's bed next to her while she watched TV, and I really wanted to tell her what I had done, but I was terrified of what she would say. So I just sat there with her for a couple hours, and then, you know, I was over it the next day. And about a week later, I tried it again. I got high, and I loved it, you know. And I thought, you know, I want to do this every single day. And that was in ninth grade. So 6 months into ninth grade, basically, I went from, you know, smoking marijuana every other weekend to becoming a daily marijuana smoker every single day. And that progressed to trying some other drugs and trying other things. And, you know, I gotta speed this up a little bit, so I apologize, I'm just gonna skip things. But basically, by the time, you know, I was 15 years old, I was using cocaine, Oxycontin, regularly on a daily basis. And I found out there were ways to skip school, and I started doing that. And basically, by the time I was 16, I was addicted to Oxycontin. I didn't know that because for me growing up, like, I didn't have any, like, real responsibilities. You know, I had to go to school. That was about it. I didn't have to have a job. I didn't have to help provide for my family. I didn't have to put food on the table. Like, anything like that. You know, I had a pretty easy life. I was a spoiled kid from East Scott, was what it came down to. And I was able just to hang out with friends after school and, like, do these things. And because of that, my addiction progressed very quickly. By the time, you know, I was in the 10th grade, I was skipping school regularly. I got arrested for the first time when I was 16 years old. I got arrested for burglary. I got charged as a juvenile, and I was with a bunch of adults, and my parents sent me to a program for the first time. I got home from that program, went to a private school. I got kicked out of that private school because I decided to start smoking crack in the parking lot. I went to treatment again. And ultimately, I went to treatment about five more times. And in 2005, I crashed my car into a tree. I was 18. I had become an IV heroin user. That was my drug of choice. I had been using it for about pretty much 2 years now, every single day. And I crashed my car into a tree. I was 17 when it happened. I got four felonies and two misdemeanors, and I went to jail, and my parents had to put their house up to get me out of jail. And my only thought in jail was, like, it wasn't, hey, there might be something wrong with your life. It was, I really need to get out of here because I don't like the way I'm feeling, and I'm starting to withdraw. There was no thought about my family or anything like that. And, you know, I got out of jail, and my parents told me I was going to treatment again. I was absolutely, you know, that's not what I wanted to do. I thought it was a terrible idea. I'd been to treatment multiple times. So I jumped out of their car while they were getting off the highway, and I was in jail, so I didn't have, like, shoelaces in or anything, so, like, I couldn't really run, so they picked me right back up. And I had, like, a little mini intervention, and I went to treatment again. Came home from treatment, and I made it 4 days outside of treatment before my parents kicked me out of their house because I started using heroin again. And I got put into, I had all these felonies, so my choices were drug court, or go to prison, or try to do probation. And I knew that, like, I probably wasn't going to be successful at probation. And I remember them, like, kept telling me at drug court, like, you have felonies, you're not going to be able to vote. And I kept being like, I wasn't really planning on voting. Like, I think this is going to be okay. Like, it'll work out. And, I went to drug court. I remember I signed a piece of paper. Like, I remember this very clearly. They're like, you're in our program now. If you have a urine screen, will it be clean? And I was like, yeah. So I peed in a cup, and it was really dirty, and I went to jail until I could, you know, have a clean drug screen. That's the first time I went to jail where I could, like, remember it. I hated it. And I'll tell you, I got out of jail, and the drug court told me I was 18, and I was supposed to go to my senior prom in high school. This was my fifth high school I was in, the fourth high school. And I went to prom that night, and I was I was sober, and I hated myself. Like, I didn't know who I was, I didn't know how to talk to people, I couldn't relate to anybody, I wanted to crawl out of my own skin, and like, I wanted to kill myself that night, because like, I didn't like who I was or who I'd become, and the only thing I knew what to do was to get high, and that's what I did. I went and I got high, I went back to jail, I got out of jail again, and I started doing this drug court program, and I found out, this was in 2005, and I found out basically I could use Oxycontin to get away with it, and I did for a really like short period of time. And I ended up going to jail again, and they said to me, you can finish our program, get out of jail, or you can get out of our program and do your prison sentence, pretty much. And I said, like, I'll just go to prison. Like, I've been in treatment 6 times. And they were like, well, that's a pretty bad idea. And I wasn't really thinking clearly, like I said. And I went to jail, I detoxed, and like, I guess like 8 days later I woke up and I was like sober for the first time that I could remember in like a really long time. Like this realization hit me where I was like this white Jewish kid from East Cobb, and like, I wasn't fitting in like I thought I would. And like, I was pretty terrified, and I called my dad and I was like, listen, I gotta get out of here. You gotta do something, I want help. And I really didn't want help, I just really wanted to get out of jail. And they hadn't really kicked me out of drug court yet, and the judge was like, you can go to this one treatment center in Mississippi, and I was like, sure, I'll go. And so I went to treatment for the 7th time in 2005. My sobriety date is July 6, 2005, that's when I got sober. The last time I used a drug was in jail, I smoked pot in jail. That was the last time. My dad was driving me to this treatment center, and I said to him, I thought you weren't going to pay for any more treatment centers. And basically what he said to me was, I want to make sure I did everything I did for you as a parent before you died, because he was convinced I was going to die. I got into treatment. I was the youngest person there by like a good 15 years. I was balding, but like not like I'm balding now. Like I'm balding, like unhealthy, like really malnourished, like yellow, hair falling out type of balding, and really frail, like 140 pounds. I hadn't really eaten anything but like a McDonald's cheeseburger for the last 3 years, like one a day. And, you know, I was there, and this counselor basically told me, he said, you're 18 years old, you're a heroin addict, you're gonna die, you're gonna get sober, and it's your choice. And he made it really like plain and simple, and like, I'd gone to a lot of like adolescent programs, and nobody was like that like blunt with me, and it kind of freaked me out a little bit. And you know, he gave me some things to start doing. He introduced me to like a God as I understand him, and I started praying and I started doing some things, and they introduced me to a 12-step program that ultimately saved my life. And like throughout treatment, like when I got out of treatment, after like 90 days, like I still felt terrible about myself. Like when I woke up, like I didn't really want to get high anymore. But I hated who I was, I hated who I'd become, I hated how I hurt my family. I had this terrible like self-esteem, like there was nothing like to be proud of in my life. My parents didn't want to talk to me because they paid for 7 treatment centers and they thought they were gonna get burned again. So I got out of treatment and I got put into another drug court in the state of Mississippi that corresponded with Cobb County Drug Court, so they wanted me to come back to the state of Georgia, which ultimately saved my life. And I had to go to court every Tuesday for about a year and a half. I had to do all the things you have to do in drug court. I went to a meeting every single day for 2 years. A lot of things. And like the judges were saying, drug court didn't, it was one of the huge things that saved my life. It kept me accountable when there was, a lot of room to, have a lot of free time. I didn't have that when I first got sober. And I realized like what a felony was pretty quick when I got fired from a buffet for having a felony. Like I thought like, this is not my choice job, like who works here if felons don't work here? And I got fired for having a criminal record. But I got involved with the right people, and for me, like I said, I felt like a drug addict. I felt really like, I just felt terrible about like who I was. And I got a sponsor in a 12-step program that suggested like very strongly that I go back to high school and finish. And I went back to high school and finished, and I started going to college. and I worked. I had two part-time jobs. I went to school part-time. I got a dog. I got an apartment. And I started like living my life and kept people very close to me. And somehow like I found this lady started tutoring me, and she started tutoring me, and she signed me up for the ACT, and I did really, really, really good on it and got a full ride scholarship to the University of Southern Mississippi, and I went down there. And I at this time I had probably like 2.5 years sober. I was very involved in like a 12-step program, very involved in like helping other people get sober. You know, very, very proud to be in college and to be getting educated because it changed the way I felt about myself. Because I felt self-worth when I could raise my hand and say, I know the answer to that, or, you know, whatever it was. Like, I was feeling good about what I was doing. And I went back to the state of Georgia and got all my charges dropped for having, you know, 4 felonies and misdemeanors because the judges in Mississippi showed up to my court date and spoke on my behalf because of the work I had done with them and everything. So I had all my charges clear. And I went down to the University of Southern Mississippi for school, and a month into school, my mom called me on September 14th of 2008 and let me know that my sister had died of a drug overdose. And I always said, like, if something happened to my sister, that was going to be the thing that kind of threw me over the edge where I was going to go and get high. And it didn't. Like, something took over my body and basically, you know, carried me and allowed me to do the things that I needed to do to take care of myself. And I went back. My parents were out of town on their 30th anniversary on a cruise, and they couldn't get back into the country. So I was like 22 years old. I had 3.5 years sober, and I went and I planned my sister's funeral and dressed her and everything. And you know, it's really unfortunate that that happened, and it, you know, it saddened me, and it gives me a lot of passion for what I do today. But you know, I was able to be there for my parents for the first time. They were able to see the man that I'd become. And after that, I moved back to Georgia. I was going to go to University of Georgia, and I went up there, and I went to Five Guys Burgers and Fries, and like I saw a bunch of people from high school, and I decided like I didn't want to be around those people, and I decided to go to Kennesaw State and get a job in Kennesaw. And Kennesaw had a program for students who are in recovery. Then it was called the Collegiate Recovery Center. Now it's called the Center for Young Adult Addiction Recovery. And it's run by a lady named Teresa Johnston. And it's for students who are in recovery to go back to college. And I had no idea what it was, nor did I want to have any part of it. But they asked me to come speak one Monday night and tell my story. And my story usually lasts like an hour, not like 12 minutes. So, anyways, like, I went out there, I spoke, and like, I really like enjoyed the people because I went to college. I've been in college for 3 years, and like, I never felt like a student except when I was in class. Like, I didn't have any like friends on campus. Like, I literally went to a 12-step meeting. I went to school and I got off campus and hung out with my friends who were in recovery. Because there's tons of young people in recovery out there, like tons. And then when I went to Kennesaw State, like all of a sudden, like these recovering young people were like on campus. And you know, they were students and they were trying to do the same thing I was trying to do, which was kind of like start over, feel privileged and honored to be a student, get a degree and get a job somewhere. And basically, I became part of that program. My major is marketing and professional sales, and the lady asked me to go to Texas Tech, which started like collegiate recovery, and speak on a panel to the U.S. Board of Education. And I just said, are y'all paying for me to go? Because if you're paying, I'll go, but I can't pay for myself. And I went out there and I spoke, and when I saw what they had out there, you know, I was in shock. And they have a collegiate recovery program out there that's not like any other program really in the country, where like once a student has a year sober, like they'll waive your out-of-state fees, give you scholarship money, priority registration, guarantee your admission. They have their own major, they have their own master's program. And the cool thing is they've replicated the program. And they've put it at Kennesaw State, the University of Georgia, and Georgia Southern, and Alabama. And, you know, it's really neat to see, like, the whole collegiate recovery movement grow. But they let me go out there, and I spoke out there. And then I came back to Atlanta. I was like on fire with this collegiate recovery thing, and I was really all about it. And the lady who ran the program I worked for at the time asked me if I wanted to come work there, and I was like, no. no, I don't want to work for a treatment center. Like, I want to work for a hockey team. Like, that was, but thanks for offering. Like, and then the Thrashers got sold. And, I called that lady back. Hey, is that offer still there? And basically, I went out there in my senior year of college. I had a year left of school, and I learned more about collegiate recovery. And I had the opportunity to go work for a treatment center. And I did. And when I, you know, the thing is, when I graduated college, when I had about 5.5 years sober, I was 24 years old. And the thing was, I got to pretty much start my life over at 18 years old. I had no life skills when I got sober. I got to relearn everything, developmentally, everything. I got to reestablish relationships with my family. I got to graduate college. I got to walk. I moved to New Mexico for a year, which is, you know, like, I'm really glad to be back in Atlanta, but I lived out there, and, you know, the thing is that I love what I get to do for a living. I get to work with, you know, families and help them find treatment for, you know, their loved ones, regardless of, you know, where they go, but that's basically what I get to do is, you know, families call me, and I get to help place them, and, you know, the community of people who work in this business in Atlanta is, you know, it's amazing. And there's other people in the room who do what I do. There's David Blackwell in the back, if you'll raise your hand. There's Kelly Grant here. And they do the same thing I do. And we all help place families with the same passion as if they were our own family. And, you know, there's a lot of resources here, and there's a lot of parent groups here, and there's a lot of, like, things you can do. But, like, for me, my mom always comes up to me and says, like, she doesn't say this anymore, but she says, do you think there's anything I could have done differently for you or your sister? And, you know, I say, you know, I don't think there is anything that you could have done differently, but what my parents do is they speak to a lot of families, and I'm very open about my recovery, and I speak a lot. And, you know, a lot of people call me and just ask for help, and there's 12-step meetings all over the state of Georgia. There's tons of young people's meetings, and, you know, basically I would just... And I say, I'm not a parent, obviously. Well, I might be, you never know, but I'm not. And, you know, I would say, if you think that your child has a drug problem, I'm going to tell you is that the last person they want to hear from is you. They don't want to hear you in their face. And I would really suggest, like, go take them to somebody who's in recovery and let them tell what's going on, what it was like for them, because that can really change how they view things. And I thank you all for speaking and saying what you had to say, and thank you for letting me be a part of this.
Thank you so much. Thank each of you for helping brought to this meeting tonight. And we had planned to open the floor up to questions. I think since we've run really late, and a lot of you I know have got children you want to get home, we'll go ahead and close the meeting with Dr. Evans. And then this panel will stay around, and any of you that have questions, feel free to come up and ask, because I don't want to keep you longer so you won't ever come back again.
Good evening. Thank you, Cindy. My name is Buster Evans, and I am fortunate and privileged to serve as your county school superintendent. I really want to applaud you for being here tonight, but I do recognize that I am in the unenviable position of being the only thing between some of you and a John Smoltz baseball man. So I'm going to keep my comments brief because so much. They might leave. But we'll keep comments very, very brief. So much has been said tonight. You've had an opportunity to hear from people who are experts, people who are truly concerned about your children, people who are concerned about this community, people who have made it their lifelong mission to try to help the lives of others be better. And I'm grateful to be able to be up here on this stage with people such as this. This evening you've heard from those who've given us a lot of information, from our Cy Young winner, future Hall of Famer John Smoltz. Thank you for setting the stage, talking about passion. And that is one thing that sets this community apart from so many communities. Cindy, over 35 years ago, I was involved in drug prevention education throughout my career as an educator. I've never seen a community event like this, so thank you for your leadership in putting this together, and we owe you a tremendous round of applause for your work. During the time that I've had to know those others who are on the panel tonight, people like Sheriff Piper, Judge Bagley, Judge Jackson, they've constantly given of their time. And there are a couple of things that I do want to say in closing that I think are important. But for most people, it said there are two things that you can look at to tell what's important to them. And that is their checkbook or their bank statement. And the other thing is their calendar. For those of you who are here tonight, you've given up your time, perhaps because you're concerned about a child. Maybe you're concerned about a grandchild. Maybe you're concerned about someone else's child. But we thank you for giving up your time because you have demonstrated that this is important. For others, they've given up their money, and we greatly value for them. Bradley, we thank you for talking about identifying those stages and those issues that people will go through that somehow or the other we get in denial about, and we don't recognize the importance of early intervention and being involved and knowing what those signs are about. Sherry, as I looked into the audience tonight as you were speaking, I could see that you giving of your heart touched into the heart of what perhaps are roughly 500 people that I've estimated in this room. But thank you for giving your heart to us tonight, and we give our heart and our love to you. Daniel, we thank you from a young person's standpoint. As I'm sitting there thinking about you at your point, I think about my own children. And I think about the fact that you're at that age, very well could have been them, but you've talked about the fact that it's something that's very important for all of us to recognize, that there's hope. And John Maxwell has said, where there's hope in the future, there's power in the present. And because there's hope in the future for the children of Forsyth County, there's a tremendous amount of power in this room. And I hope that we don't leave here tonight with a lack of commitment to ensuring that for the future, our community and the future of our young people, and hopefully making the lives of those people who are here in the uniforms and those who are here representing our legal system tonight, that we actually make their lives easier. But what can I say in closing that I think really, really is important? As I've indicated, two things are important to us, time and money. I've heard that quoted for many years, and as parents, I guess what I encourage you to think about, even though this is not certainly a sure thing, but I've heard it said for a long time that if you know the 90% rule, that's one step of information that will be on your side. But if you know who and where your children spend 90% of their time with, and where they're spending 90% of their money, I think you will have some idea of what's going on in your children's life. Finally, and I hope not, but it's a very good possibility that for some of you along the way, there may be someone in your child's life who's employed with the Forsyth County School System. Tonight, I've been heartened to see a number of counselors, psychologists, school administrators, school board members, and it's been alluded to tonight, people who spend an awful lot of time with your children. In fact, spend more time with your children than you spend with your children. So if someday one of our personnel comes to you and wants to have a conference with you and says, we're concerned about your behavior, please don't get mad at us. Please understand it's because we love your children. And when we see things taking place in their life that don't add up with them being successful in our environment, we feel a sense of calling to come together. And perhaps we've gotten it wrong. But if we did, please forgive us and just understand it's because we care deeply about your children. There's one thing that we would like to ask you to do as you leave tonight is we do have evaluations that are on your table. As we plan future opportunities and future educational programs for our community, we need to know what's important to you. So if you will just take a couple of minutes to fill out those evaluations, you can leave them on the table, and we'll take those and process those. And we commit to you that we will debrief about your comments and about what you found of value. So again, I want to thank you for your time, because your time tonight has demonstrated that this is an important topic. Thank you for being here. God bless each of you, and God bless for Forsyth County. Thank you. three baseballs to give away tonight, and we'll draw very, very quickly. And the first one that we're going to give away is to Denise Buchanan. Denise. The second one that we'll give away is to Scott Wilbanks. Scott. And our third and final baseball, Gail Nearing. Gail.
Thank you again for coming, and if you've got any questions, feel free to come up here. Thank you so much. Oh, and I was supposed to mention, there is a new foundation. Joanne Daniel brought some things out on the table. They suffered a loss in their family due to prescription drug overdose, and they've started a foundation. They've got pamphlets out on the table that tells you a lot about prescription drugs and things and signs to watch for, and she can get more of those for you if you need them in your business. Thank you so much for coming. God bless you.